Baruch Hashem, Yahuwah, welcome, welcome to another Turtle Side Chat. I'm your host, Shaliach Moshe Yosef Konachowski. It's wonderful to have you again here with us, coming to another live service from Goshen B'Tzafon. I have my coffee. How about you? It's been a while since I've been with you. We're going to continue in part four of the message, The Lost Art of Shouting. I hope I can finish it today so we can begin another series. The Lost Art of Shouting. Welcome to Turtle Side Chat Video School. And we pray that you're reviewing and not missing any of these teachings, or I simply cannot recognize your studies with us, and certainly it'll be difficult for us to grant you ordination as an ambassador with your arms to Israel International Ministries unless we know that you're diligently following and catching up on the teachings. So Baruch Hashem Yahuwah, again I want to welcome you. We're going to go right to the word. Last part three, we ended in Second Chronicles chapter 15, okay? And just by way of review, Second Chronicles, Divrei Hayamim Beit 15 and 14, they swore to Yahuwah with a loud voice, okay? So when the when Israel celebrates, when Israel gathers, when Israel is triumphant, okay? When, for instance, this is speaking about the Ruach of Elohim and coming to the prophet Azariahu, and King Asa hears these words. He took courage, and King Asa put away the idols in Israel, in the land of Yehuda and Benjamin, and he brought revival, or the prophet Azariahu brought revival through King Asa. And so they gathered to the house of worship, they renewed the covenant with Yahuwah, and they shouted with a loud voice. So we see shouting, the lost art of shouting, is recovered when we renew the covenant with Yahuwah as Israel. When we return to the covenant, when we have victory, when we have triumph, when we are in His presence, when we want to seek His presence, when we want to declare His presence, when we want to declare His lordship, we want to declare that when two or three are gathered in My name, that He is there in the midst of Israel. And when the ark moved forward, when the walls came down, whenever Yahuwah was on the march, or we desired to bring Him into our midst, to bring Him into our presence, then it is important that we restore the lost art of shouting. See, because right now Israel, 2 Chronicles 15, 14, they're learning how to sound the shofar and blow the chatzot shrot, the silver trumpets, but we cannot forget that it must be accompanied with a loud voice and shouting. Does that make us Pentecostal? Not in the terms of the Christian church's understanding of Pentecostalism, but let us not forget that the 120 Talmidim, along with the 12 Shlichim, were in the temple, in one of the rooms in the house of Yahuwah, in the house where they were all sitting. Later on, 3,000 believers were mikvahed, so we know it was not an upper room. We know it was one of the rooms of the house of Yahuwah, the temple, where they were supposed to be gathering on Shavuot, on Pentecost. So we see here that the shouting, the yelling, is something that the devil has tried to silence. And number two, religion has tried to hijack on their own without following the Torah. So we see it when we as Nazarene Israelites or Hebrew roots believers see yelling and screaming and tongue-talking and all the gifts of the Ruach, which are true, which are perpetual, because we do believe in the perpetuity of all the gifts of the Ruach, as well as the gifts of Yeshua, the fivefold ministry. The gifts of Yeshua are different than the gifts of the Ruach. The gifts of Yeshua are found in Ephesians chapter 4 in great detail. The gifts of the Ruach are outlined in 1 Corinthians 12, 1 Corinthians 11, places like that. So we see that we've got to recover shouting in Israel, because the joy of Yahuwah is our strength, and the joy is manifested through shouting out of the abundance of the heart. The vocal cords will speak, the vocal cords will sing, the vocal cords will proclaim, the vocal cords. And so if we're shy and laid back, and we don't learn to readopt the art of the shout, then what's going to happen is the devil will not be stilled, and he'll be shouting lies. He'll be shouting falsehoods. He'll be shouting murder, because the thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy, Yohanan 10:10. And he's been shouting the same message for millennia. And most of mankind has received and adopted the message that he's been shouting. So he shouts lies and murder and falsehood through his cunning. Religion shouts grace, grace, grace without a law of obedience, because Yeshua said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. And he says, if you keep my commandments, I will heal you and I will give you the benefits of obedience. And then none of the plagues and the makot of Mitzrayim, Egypt, will come upon you. But so people say, why do I need to follow the Torah? Very simply, for protection, for guardianship and protection, so that none of the plagues and diseases of Egypt come upon us, that we're the head and not the tail, from above and not beneath. So it is extremely important that you do not allow bad experiences that you had in the church, now that you've come out of that church system and you're following Torah and Yeshua, which are one and the same, the living Torah and the oral Torah that comes out of his mouth never contradicts the written Torah. It elaborates or explains the heart of the matter, but it never contradicts it in any way. And so we need to recover the lost art of shouting if we want the results that our forefathers had when Yahweh was in their midst. And today it doesn't take a lot. It takes a couple of sanctified voices yelling and screaming. And it takes the sound of the shofar, the sound of the trumpets, etc. Now let's go to see examples in the Brit Chadashah, in Yochanan Moshe chapter 11. So hopefully we'll be able to finish this series. I believe this is now part 4. Yochanan Moshe chapter 11, 9. And they went before, and they that followed. This, of course, is when Yeshua is entering triumphantly into Jerusalem. Hoshiana Baruch Haba B'Shem Yahuwah Adonai. Blessed is he that comes in the name of Yahuwah. Blessed is the Malchut, the kingdom of our Abba, David, who comes in the name of Yahuwah. So the Talmidim who were ahead of Yeshua on the donkey and behind, in fulfillment of the promise that the Messiah would be presented to Israel as the Lamb of Yahuwah on a donkey before Passover, we see the fulfillment of Zechariah 9:9. But you notice that they shouted. They didn't just go, shh, let's go into Yerushalayim, shh, so we don't upset the Prushim and the Tzadukim, and, you know, so we don't make too much noise. See? I love this beautiful Paleo pendant. Blessed is he who comes, notice, who comes in the name of Yud He Vav He. This is Yahuwah in Paleo Hebrew. I wear these, and now we offer them in the store. Write to me, and we'll let you know how you can get them. I love it. I never take it off. It's fantastic. Except when I shower and bathe. Yeah, I'm one of those weird rabbis and shliachs that actually washes and bathes. Can you believe that? Radical stuff, huh? Radical, radical stuff. But anyway, so this is awesome. Now, he's coming in the name of Yahuwah, and when the king of Israel comes, there's a shout. We shout, hey, the king, Yeshua, the promised Messiah, the Lamb, the Holy One of Israel, the one that Moshe and the Torah and the prophets did speak of. He's here, he's here, he's here, hello! And they get all excited and calling their neighbors and their friends. The lost art of shouting It's the devil who wants you quiet. It's your wife who wants you quiet. It's your child who wants you quiet. It's your uncle and your aunt who wants you quiet. But Yahuwah wants you shouting his tehillot, his praises, because whenever we shout, the king enters the picture. Did you get that? Whenever we shout, whether you're depressed, whether you're suicidal, whether you're confused, whether you're downcast, whether you feel overweight and bloated, whether you're aching, arthritis, when you shout, hallelujah, hallelujah, praise God, the king enters the picture. Just like when the shouting, we see here in Yochanan Moshe, the king entered Yerushalayim in the name of Yud Hey Vav Hey, the king entered the picture. Now let's fast forward to Acts, the book of Acts, Maaseh Shlichim, the works of the apostles, the Acts of the apostles. More accurately, should be said, the Acts of the Ruach, Maaseh HaRuach. And the people gave a shout, saying, it is the voice of a mighty one, not of a man. So we see the false king, as opposed to the true king, Herod, or all false kings, In Acts 12:21, like all false kings, he was on his throne, he gave a verbal address, he was dressed in royal apparel, and the people shouted, oh, it is the voice of a god, G-O-D, gold, and not a man. And see, the heavenly Malach of Yahuwah killed Herod. So people wonder what happened to Herod Antipas. He was killed by an angel, because he didn't tell the people that he was not the true G-O-D, but that Yeshua HaMashiach is the true King of Israel, and Abba Yahuwah is the true Elohim. He is Yud Hey Vav Hey. You see? He was killed because he did not give Yahuwah Tiferet. Herod was eaten by worms. He gave up his Ruach. And then when this miracle occurred, Acts 12:24, the word of Yahuwah grew and was multiplied. Okay, so we see here that shouting is always done in the presence of a king. And we see that the world shouts for the kings of the world. When the kings of the world come, when the prime ministers, the leaders of the world come, the world gets excited. Oh, you know, the president's coming to town. Oh, the vice president's going to be at the shopping mall. Hey, let's go see him. Let's announce it. Let's spread the word. Let's get a picture. Let's get an autograph. Hey, let's get a selfie. Let's get a groupie. Okay? And yet when it comes to the 25, 30 minutes on Shabbat or on the feast that are designated for worship, we sit there like this. My back. What time is it? How many songs are we doing? Okay, all the time, the king is among us. We want his presence. We want his gifts. We want his benefits. Psalm 103, verse 1 and 2. But we don't want to shout for it. We don't mind blowing the trumpet for it. We don't mind sounding the shofar, but we're not willing to shout. Shout, man. Don't just say, hallelujah, brother. Hallelujah. No, shout. Yeah! Shout, man. Because Herod is a type of every worldly king. And they receive the shouts of men. You see? And they receive the shouts of men as idolatry and as adulation. Baruch Hashem Yahuwah. Let's see if we could find another couple of examples in the Brit Chadashah. Okay? We may be pretty close to being done, but I want to see here. Okay. In Maaseh Shlichim 24:21, we see that Shaliach Shaul is taken prisoner, and he of course is questioned. And in Acts Maaseh Shlichim 24, verses 12, 13, he says, I confess that I follow the way. So the early believers were called either Nazarenes. We know they were Israelites, so we refer to them as Nazarene Israelites, not, so that they don't, we don't get confused with the Nazarene church, the modern-day Nazarene church. They were Nazarenes, Israelites, but they were also known as members of the way, and it says what members of the way did as opposed to the modern church. We see in Acts 24:14, members of the way, of which religion calls heretical, even people today call it heretical. He says, Paul says, I worship Eloha, the Eloha of my Avot, my fathers, believing all things that are written, all things, including the stuff, the hard stuff about biblical Torah marriage, plural marriage, things like that. I believe it all. I have no problem with it because I'm his disciple. He's not my disciple. And if you're constantly fighting and arguing with him because you get all emotional and scared that I'm going to lose my husband or whatever your problem is, then you're not a disciple. You need to bring it down. You need to tone it down. And you need to admit that Yahuwah has sent Latter-day prophets to Israel and that the prophets are declaring to you the full counsel of Yahuwah, not adding or taking away, and that we are to obey his word and not fight against his word. We are members of the way. What do members of the way do? Acts 24:14, we believe we're heretics in the world's eyes and in religion's eyes, but we follow all things that are written in the Torah and the Nevi'im. Together, the prophets and the Torah and the writings are all called the Tanakh. Okay? They're all called the Tanakh. Baruch Hashem Yahuwah. Let me see where we had it. So now in the same chapter, Acts 24:21, he says, for this declaration, I stood before the Sanhedrin of Israel, the ruling 70 elders, and I shouted regarding the resurrection of the dead. In other words, I proclaimed the resurrection of the dead to the leaders of Israel, not just to the mobs in Corinth and the mobs in Athens and Ephesus, but I stood before the leaders of Israel. They did not find any evil in me. I'm a member of the way. The member of the way believes everything that the Torah and the prophets said about the Messiah. And then when the Messiah comes, we receive the Torah that comes out of his mouth. Sometime he's repeating the written Torah like he does in Matthew chapter 4 when he's warring against S period, A period, Tan. But other times he's giving additional view and insight into the written Torah, and that is called the oral Torah or Torah Shebe'al Peh. The only oral Torah that we are allowed to follow is from one rabbi, not the rabbi, it's one rabbi, and that rabbi is the Lamb of Yah, Yeshua HaMashiach, who takes away the sin of the world. And Paul said, when I stood before the Sanhedrin, I wasn't quiet. See? Look at verse 21, Acts 24:21. When I stood before the Sanhedrin, I shouted it, baby. My hands were chained. I couldn't blow the shofar. My hands were chained. I couldn't blow the chatzot shofar. But one thing they couldn't take away from me was my voice. Not unless they cut out my vocal cords. Okay? And I shouted regarding the resurrection of the dead that I'm called into question. And I shouted that Yeshua, who was dead, is alive, and he is alive forevermore. And I shouted it in front of the Sanhedrin, in front of the leaders, in front of the chief men of Israel. I raised my voice. I shouted out concerning the resurrection of the dead. I am brought here this day and being questioned by you leaders. Okay, so he had no problem shouting out the message, because it had to do with the resurrection, it had to do with the king, and as we saw earlier with Herod and all the, as a type, as a model of all the other false kings, it is most proper to shout for victory and honor when you are in the presence of a king. So what we do here at Goshen B'Tzafon, our worship is alive, our worship is active, our worship is interactive. We don't just come to eat, we don't just come to receive, we come to seize the moment, to seize the appointed time, to seize the opportunity to exercise our calling as Kohanim, to exercise our calling as Kohanim in the order Darche Malkitzedek, in the Derech, the order of Malkitzedek, as members of the way. Because our early forefathers were called Nazarenes. We see that in Acts 24:5. And then later on in Acts 24:12 and 13, same chapter, we see that the Nazarenes were also known as members of the way. Okay? So the members of the way are also known as the Nozrim, the Nazarenes. And it's interesting that the Hebrew word today in modern Hebrew for Christians is Nazarenes. Okay? So that means a lot of the Christians are actually descended from the people of Israel, but they don't know it. They're Nazarenes, they're Nozrim, or branches. So even when we stand before the leaders of Israel or before men, we are to often use our vocal cords and shout the message, because in shouting we give honor, we give glory. Now go, Paul knew this principle also for the returning 10 tribes of Israel, the Nozrim. So the original 10 tribes went out into the nations, became the fullness of the Gentiles. So the Melo HaGoyim, the fullness of the Gentiles, Genesis 48:19, returned to the people of Israel, mostly as Nozrim, believing all things that were written in the Torah and the prophets. Okay? So that's how I know they couldn't be against such Hebraic customs as biblical marriage, Torah marriage, because they believed all things. It's we who've got a problem with marrying and raising our children the way Yahuwah told us to. We don't have a problem with homeschooling, but when it comes to Torah marriage, we're so emotional and so verklempt that it's embarrassing. It's embarrassing our childish reactions to the ways of Yahuwah, all the while claiming to be fully out of the church system. Galatians 4 and 27, he speaks about the Jerusalem above. Yerushalayim above is free, it's the mother of all believers. So the Jerusalem below is the mother of national Jewish Israel. Most of Jewish Israel remains in unbelief, fear, doubt, and unbelief. But for born-again believers, or the renewed covenant of Israel, or the commonwealth of Israel, the body of Yeshua, the commonwealth of Israel, we are citizens of the heavenly Yerushalayim, the mother of us all. We have an excellent series of teachings on our YouTube channel about the mother of us all, okay, our mother above, and I really suggest you immediately go looking for it. It says, Gilayu Baron, that's the 10 tribes, the other wife. Yahuwah has two wives, the house of Judah and the house of Israel. He's married to both, and his goal is to take them out of the nations and make them one family, and learn how to get along without vexation, without jealousy. So through his Ruach, it can be done. He wants it to be done, and through his Messiah, it will be done. And when he takes these two wives, we also known as the two wives, Ochala, Ochaliba, who also happen to be sisters, and he takes those two sticks. So today in the Nazarene movement, the Israelite movement, the Messianic two-house movement, does teach it. They just don't want to call it what it is. They call it the two-shtick-shtick. But the truth behind the two sticks is the fact that Yahuwah has these two wives. They used to be one family. They split. And now, through the Messiah, he wants to reunite this family with these two separate wives into one family. And he says, rejoice, Gilah, you who did not bear, break forth, shout for Simcha, joy, you did not have labor. For the barren and deserted wife, notice, that's the house of Israel, Joseph, the 10 tribes, non-Jewish Israel, the 10 tribes will have more children for Yahuwah, more born-again spiritual children who love Yahuwah and keep his commandments, than she who had a husband, meaning Jewish Israel. That's an amazing scripture we see there, that in the end days, the returning 10 tribes from the nations, many of you listening to my voice, that's why you love Torah, you love Yeshua, you love Shabbat, you love Passover, you want to obey the Moedim, and now you're learning how to be Israel by incorporating shouting into your repertoire of shofar blowing and trumpet blowing. That's proof that the prophecy of Isaiah is being fulfilled, that the children of the barren wife, that's Ephraim or the house of Israel, Joseph, house of Joseph, will have more faithful remnant believers for Yeshua, following Yeshua, the anointed one, than the one who has a husband, the house of Judah. So right there we see Paul referring to the two wives of Israel. One barren, okay, who was rejected, the house of Israel, because of her whoring and unfaithfulness. But in the end, when Yahuwah takes her back and cleans her up and dies for her, freeing her from her idolatry, he'll take her back after his resurrection and begin to deal with her, and she'll produce more fruit than the other wife, the house of Judah. So if Yahuwah has two wives, blessed are those who are called and do it in love the way Yahuwah has. We don't judge them, we don't condemn them, because in so doing we would be judging our Torah, and in so doing we would be judging the very two-house doctrine that we claim to believe in and to teach, and we claim is actually so vital. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 16, when Yeshua returns to fully restore these two brides into one family, he says this. Paul says, the Master himself will descend from the Shamayim, the heavens, with a shout. In other words, with the voice of the chief heavenly Malach. So Gabriel, who's the minister of media, Gabriel, the minister, the heavenly minister of media, whether it's all kinds of media, social media, heavenly media, in this case, it's heavenly social media, heavenly social media. Gabriel will shout, he'll use his own voice to shout, and then Yahuwah will blow his own shofar as a tikia gedola, as a long blast, and the dead Messiah will rise, we who are alive and remain, verse 17, 1 Thessalonians 4 will be caught up together with the resurrected believers to meet the Master Yeshua in the air, and we will ever live and be with the Master Yeshua, never again to be separated from our Creator. But you see, even his return, because it's the return of a king, causes the heavenly minister of media, social media, heavenly social media, to blow his voice along with Yahuwah sounding his own shofar. So notice, Yahuwah sounds the shofar, but the voice of the chief heavenly Malach of communication, Gabriel, will shout. So we see that the return of the king will not be without a shout. Just like we read earlier in Mark, the first coming of the king was with a great shout. Okay? The Hebrew word again, tzak, litzok, to shout. Tzaka, tzaaka, to shout. The Hebrew word for righteous is tzadaka. So in essence, tzaaka litzadaka. We shout for righteousness. We shout for the king. Tzaaka lemelech, to the king. Tzaaka bishvil haking, on behalf of the king. Tzaaka lifnei haking, the king, before the melech. So that's a beautiful thing that we see at the return of Yeshua, that even the heavenly Malach Gabriel will join the company that is beneath in announcing to us the return of the king. So when Yeshua entered triumphantly into Yerushalayim as the Lamb of Yah to take away the sins of the Olam, the first time those who were going before him and after him were shouting and crying out, blessed is he who comes in the name of Yud, Hey, Vav, Hey, blessed is the Melech of Israel. And so at the second coming, when the dead are about to get their reward, because the reward is with Yeshua, the dead will rise, and then the generation that sees him return, 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 through 17, we who are alive and remain will be caught up. That is not a rapture, that is part B of the resurrection. Let me say that again. When we who are alive and remain and are changed, we are not raptured. We are part B of the premillennial post-tribulation resurrection. There are two parts to the resurrection, part A and part B. There's no such thing as part A, resurrection, third coming, part B, rapture, second coming, or three comings, okay? That's where people get the rapture. They take the second, they take the resurrection and divide it into two parts. The living, rapture, and the dead, resurrection. No, they are part A and part B of the same coin, the same, they're two sides of the same coin, the singular resurrection. So we see that Yeshua Mashiach, Acts 3:21, is not even released from heaven until we learn how to shout, and then Gabriel himself confirms the necessity of a shout as heavenly in origin and befitting and honoring to the one and only true Melech HaMelechim and Adon Adoni. We pray this has been a blessing. If you want intense interaction, if you want to interact with me personally, just like this, with the headphones, over Skype. We can talk, we can chat. You could bring your thoughts, you can bring your questions. Write to me, we will get you added to the group, the Skype group. We're running out of space. We may even have to make another group. And so I want the true Talmidim, the true disciples that Yahuwah has assigned to our ministry to step forward. If Yahuwah has not assigned you to our ministry, go find yourself a spiritual Abba or a mentor to whom you can give honor and be faithful to them. Until next time, Shalom, Shalom, Lekol Yisrael, Me Goshen, Betzafon.